Lighter, you get happy to help. And heavy bear. You can tell they're planted. That's our part of our combat. Where we land the dead. Every village of Rob, R-A-B-D, grave, they pronounce it Rob. They march in Seattle, about 3 miles. We spent the night there, up there. Next day, we set up a tent. And the wood, not there. We did. Not just there. I didn't get there, some of them did. We come out of there. I had a pretty good friend, Salvador Delavos. He was Spanish. California. He was not Mexican, he was Spanish. But the commander wanted us to walk out there a day to find out what the mine was about. So we did. Walked along, all of us heard the crack. And around the south, she went. Lay a place down on the ground. Turned him over, had a hole in his shirt. Pretty serious with our people. Anyway, we're coming back and loading my pockets. I then put my rifle in the direction of the clock top down there and see it. Taking a chance, there's somebody out there. And I'm back to beat out in that room. Hey, one thing about it first, when you first get into combat, the first thing you smell is the cover. It's all around you. You may be miles from the fighting chat. And you have to contact the military. Smell onto them on your day of contact. They, that's my first experience with combat.
So it hadn't still had safety on it. We stopped the machine guns anyway. We get Pearl Rider and machine gun mask and then they disappeared in a hurry.
They didn't know when it was going to go.
I didn't.
When it was going to go.
Nothing done.
Well, you have the first few days in combat, you do a lot of dumb things. You don't know why you done it or why you got away with it. But that's another example of you did. They can't read their own code.
So we stayed in Holland for quite a little while. We had another skirmish a few days later, and they sent us out on night patrol, three or four of us. We got back in by, we cleaned up the weapons and reloaded them. Old Joe Martin, he didn't load it. So I said, Joe, you gonna reload your rifle? No, I never loaded it. He says, I can't kill anybody. What you gotta do with somebody out there with your finger protection, you might have a rifle loaded. So I mentioned that to the captain. He said, well, we'll transfer you to another job. So they put him on a detail carrying water cans in the back up to the line. Would you believe he was killed by a sniper? Two people that you wondered, was it my fault? You have a lot of bad feelings in that. We was in Holland about 2 months and then they started walking back to the base camp around France. We didn't know where we were going because we left England. Now we're going to attack France. Of course, here in Holland, that's clear across Belgium and into France a little bit. So we started walking. I thought that'll be a long walk. And they brought some trucks up and they took the back of the line and loaded the truck, go take them to the front and load them. They keep moving the line a little faster that way. You get to walk most of the way anyway. We finally got there. Camp Sisson, which is not Soissons, but Sisson. There's another city by the name of Soissons, which is not 6 miles west where we were at. And it was a big old stone building. It was a French army camp. It was vacant. We moved into that. The same token, I got stuck with the radio while I was in Holland because I didn't use up all my ammunition on the bazooka and my ammunition bearer, he disappeared. We just didn't find him. So we didn't have any more ammunition, so the radio man got hit. We had a big tall lieutenant about 7 foot tall. He said, Bridge, pick up that radio. I don't know how to operate that railroad. He said, you offer it, carry it, I'll offer it. We got out there and got stuck overnight in a foxhole out there with no man's land. Got back into our base where I realized they reported me as missing in action, so I didn't get mail for months. About the time we left Holland, I got the whole batch of mail at one time. We got back to France, and of course we were retraining, picking up replacements and whatnot. And then on Sunday, December the 17th, we went, hey, pack up, we're going out of here in the morning, 5 o'clock. Of course, they don't pay you nothing. Well, somebody got to checking the radio. That's when the battle of all started. So we went through on a big old open carrier. We called them cattle trucks. They weren't cattle trucks, but they were semis with no roof over it.
guys didn't even have overcoats, a lot of them didn't have armament, didn't have helmets. Because they'd lost them in Holland, we didn't have them prepared because we're gonna get replaced. Well, they do them all then. So we got into Overmont, Belgium. And that's where the unloaders is at. So then we got our cars about in the bulk there. And that went on for quite a while. We didn't get as much firefighting very quickly. But when it started, we had got a little severe. And we were moved into the lines the next day or two. That, of course, you never know where you're at. You don't know where the enemy's at. He's firing at you, and you're firing over there. You can't see each other. But when them orders comes over, he don't. They just send them over to who it may concern. So if it lands on you, like, that was your day to end. Let's see, we went into the lines there for a while. And by the time we got to that, that would happen. Oh, in early January, they took us in the little village of Pinster for R&R. And it was an old treadmill town. They were going to put us in the old treadmill. And we all got in there, and here come the citizens of the town. Three soldiers come. And they took us through their houses. We slept in their beds. They slept in the basement because the buzz bomb was coming over, so they didn't want them. But we thought about pretty damn nice. And that had been since the 17th of December, since we'd slept inside. So we kind of liked that. We were there about 7 days. And then, of course, we went back into the lines and then shortly after the first quarter. About the 3rd of this January, we got into a line in a battle, slight battle. And forget where I'm at. Oh, then we walked back out of there that night. They wanted to rearrange the line. So we can't stay down in here. We're stuck out here all by ourselves. We got to get back out of here before the Germans get in here. So they walked us out of there. Nice long walk up Christmas Eve. And we got back to La Chapelle. And filled it there in the town. And the road we walked out on, and then the engineers had fixed it all up there. Well, the road for the trees on both sides for a while. And they had it all wired with explosives. As soon as we got through there, they blow the trees down into the road so the tanks couldn't get in through there. That was one of the defensive positions. We went back to La Chapelle, and then we spent Christmas Day there and had cold turkey and a little else. Airborne doesn't have all the kitchen supplies that are standard Army military. But we're light infantry. You're airborne, you get on the ground, then you're back to infantry. But, so we got to Tenerife. I heard some noise in the basement of that house. Our house was barns that were built all in one piece. We realized there was cattle in the water down below. So we went down and worked, they were feeding water and fed and everything. We started watering them and feeding them. Zook and I was getting another farm pan. We started building them. We didn't get as much of the milk, but it disappeared faster than we could get the milk. I little town of Rignac, R-E-G-E-N-A, or E-N-E, I'm not my friendship for that. And there where we were for a few days. One of the things about Holland, I want to tell you about, Zook and I was talking there, and here come an old cow limping on one front leg. She'd got it, she called it, got a rifle blowing or something trapped in her front leg, and she was dragging it and walking. I told Zook, we might as well butcher her, but she can die anyway. Oh, we shouldn't do that. I said, she's going to die anyway. Well, okay. So we killed and slaughtered her. We had steak. It's a little hard to butcher a cow when you only got an axe and a sharp knife. And it's a hatchet, I should say, not an axe. We got her hung up in the tree and looked. First thing you know, why we had a lot of milk. Every night the smell of fire burned a long ways off. Yeah. But the government paid, it's the United States government paid her for the cows. So we had free food. Yeah. And a little talking to me. But nobody really did. Called on me very hard because they would eat the steak too. I'm running over my fair time here. But my battle experience was terrible. I come home without a hole in me. And I was lucky or somebody was watching over me, I don't know if it's. It's a terrible world, and it's hard to tell anybody else what the circumstance is unless you're there. And there's some in poor city kids that didn't get the winter time. They didn't know how to take care of themselves. They wear their clothes too tight, their shoes tied up too tight, their boots. They come in to the headquarters of the pig station. My feet hurt. How long has it been since you had your boots off? Oh, last week one day. Of course, then they take their boots off and gag the buzzard. It was terrible. It put rot. Some of the guys actually lost feet because they just ruined so much of their bones. They took their shoes off and placed them right off the roof. Mm-hmm. It's called trench foot back then. But it's a part of the war. Then we ended the war then in the Central Europe. We went through, spent some time in Cologne. Picked up our motorcycle and rode that around for a while and still occupied on the Rhine River. And your turn regiment. I never rode one. But you got to ride one, you got working on it. I crawled on it, rode out into the street, turned the corner near the street, GI walking right down the middle of the street. Nothing you can do but lay the damn thing over. So that ended my motorcycle ride. the war was getting fought over, and we went up through Hamburg and out on the north part of the Germany and met the Russians at the Elbe River. And of course there, the Russian tanks. There would be a family on the tank, father, son, daughter, four or five, whatever it took to run the tank. And they all one thing. Well, they didn't speak English and we didn't speak Russian. But you can get the message, salute, salute, salute. You know, they got a keg of vodka. Gee, that stuff would take your head off. More than I was used to. That was way past a little weird. Hey, here again, I survived the war. I got home, after my share of war, but our old high pointers, the old timers, they went, sent them on the mold. And us, in a short time, didn't have enough points. We had to stay. In the 17th Airborne, they moved the two of us together. And we went into Berlin, and for, we was in there about 4 months on Army of Occupation. Quite a lot of interesting experiences there, too. You can fly the world for a pack of cigarettes. I'll turn this over to Bob and let you tell his part of the story.
Okay.
He's the one who brought all this stuff in here. I brought some things home with me, but the 82nd was building a museum down at Fort Bragg, and I sent all my stuff down there. So if you want to see my stuff, you got to go to Fort Bragg.
There's a picture of me going
chase the cows off the runway. There was one plane come in, he was shot up pretty bad, and he couldn't get his wheels down, so he belly landed, and we had a latrine along the side of the runway, wet in buckets in England. And this plane pointed the toward the latrine, and his gun shorted out and started shooting. And the bullets went right around the latrine. There's a picture of St. St. Mary Louise. They stopped patting dead still in St. Louis. And then about 2 days later, 8th Air Force started to come over and bombed St. Louis. And by 10 o'clock, you couldn't see the sun for vapor crews. The veteran planes come over and they completely annihilated St. Louis. There was nothing left there. This is the pictures of the B-47s that we had on the field. And they weighed 8 tons unloaded. They took 600 gallons of 100-octane gasoline. They used 100 gallons an hour. And when they had to go farther, they put belly tanks under them. And that's if they did strafing. And they dropped their belly tanks before they started to attack. But if they carried bombs, they didn't use belly tanks at all. This is the artwork of some of the guys on the plane. Some of the planes take them off. They was they had 4 50-caliber machine guns on each wing, and they synchronized those guns to hit one point. There's there's the 50-caliber shells, and they fill the wings, each wing up, clear up with shells. Well, this is the tracer, the red. This is armor piercing, and I don't know. They had another black. I don't know what it was. But they dropped bombs close to a railroad. There's what happened to the truck. Their railroad ties was metal. They didn't have work, and they'd go home there. And they would just fold up. And that's a picture of me. Later on, they transferred me to the group and put me on as a radio operator on a B-25. Well, the B-25, we didn't want any bombing missions. All we did was call officers to, for R&R to southern France and liquor. We went into Belgium and loaded up liquor and brought it back to the base. And on one of the trips, we had a colonel, and he went in and he had a list of the liquor that he wanted. And I was in there, and he took his coat off. They brought out a case of Vat 65. Well, he threw his, the sergeant was gone, he threw his coat over and told him, "Get out of here." So I took it out and put it in the truck. Come back in. He said, sergeant said, "Well, you got all your left." "No, I didn't get my case of that." So he gave us a bottle that night. There's a picture of the plain eyes. I usually roll in the nose. I was on the way back from any place where you see any farmer out in the field, you have to put them on the ground. Later on, we got a C-47, B-25 cracked up and burned. And later on, got a C-47, and we took a loaded officer to southern France. And on the way back, he said to the mechanic, he said, "Do you want to stay all night in Paris?" He said, "Sure." So he said, "As soon as I stop, jump out like you're out of the car." He said, "Be out of here at 8 o'clock, probably." So we were out there at 8 o'clock. He didn't show up till 10. Drunk. Had to help him up and get him to see, to get him strapped in. And today I went away. But anyway, he took off and took up all the runway. Then he took that C-47 up like that. They don't do that. Then he pushed out and then took off. Sort of foggy too, but he's picking up ice because the wings have the icy corner. And we'd reach outside and get ice and rub over his face during the soap. There's the fire. There's the fire. He was quite a paralyzer. He wasn't flying on the P-47. They said, no, you can't. So they piggybacked us. And we was in Germany then, as well as Frankfurt. And on the way in, the motor on the front of the propeller, that's what put the pitch when they take off and cruise and so forth. It went out. So therefore, they had no propeller. We didn't do it.
Yeah.
saved me by being here. We called that, we shipped us out to the, one who didn't have enough points, shipped us to Lahar. It was detachable to go around and come in back of China. They dropped the bomb, we went straight to New York and was charged. These are German machine gun bullets. I had I picked up some bullets and they were wood nose. I don't know what the idea was. I thought I had some. This was a clothing. We had jackets the same, and we had boots. And during the winter, we probably lived in the well, this was my flight, and I got on the B-25. Way we washed it, 100 out of 10 gasoline. We washed it 100 out of 10 gasoline.
Plus all you can eat.
Take that down.
Yeah, you can find
the tents. Whenever a plane had crashed, we'd go get the hydraulic lines out of that plane and put a boat outside the tent and got a 5 gallon tank, a gas can, punch a hole in it and put rubber hose up in it, then run the tubing into the tent, down the tent hole in between, or went into the stove and put another rubber hose.
They tried to get it to us every day.
Did you know anything about the concentration camps when you were there?
We did relieve one at Rubens last year, at the end of the war, I think. It was up quite a ways north of Berlin. But they were about all Polish people in there, and a lot of kids. And of course, the kids, they were hungry, as a kid would be. And we gathered a lot of them up and took them to our mess hall with us. But you had to be careful, because if they did without food for several days, they'd eat too much, and then, of course, that's worse than starving to death. They choked their guts up, and they got enough juices to dissolve and digest it. So we fought more plus from the powers that be when we took them kids back. And you got to be careful with that, because they overeat and die on that. And the elder prisoners, that was one of the things that they wanted to eat. Of course, they got the guards all left when we showed up. And the guards then took off, and then people in prison took off. And they went into the town of Ludwigslust, and they'd go right into a house. You know, Germans didn't even have food in the time of war. But they'd get meal and shove that in their mouth, and they just, there'd no juice on it. And they actually died from it. We rounded them up as fast as we could find them. Yeah, because they put on soup, you know, and then their stomach started to work on again. The kids seem to have a better withstanding on it, because we never had any kids down there.
There at Metz, there was a fort, and it was a big fort, and Patton couldn't get them out, so they starved them out.